I think the bottom line is that we need to be paying attention to women's emotional well-being during pregnancy as much as we do to their physical well-being. And by doing so, we can help not only women, but potentially their future children.
So Dr. Monk, I'm so happy to have you here talking about your research in early development. Maybe you can start by saying a little bit about what kind of work you do, what kinds of questions you're trying to answer.
Sure. And thank you for having me here. So our work falls under the rubric of the developmental origins of health and disease. And by development, we are really starting with the fetus. And our main question is understanding the risk for what we call psychopathology. Another way to call that is really having mental health problems. So I know this is probably not how people are used to thinking about it, but we're going all the way back to the fetal period. So the developmental origins of the disease, of mental health disease, and finding how some of the early factors influencing the risk for having poor mental health outcomes may start in utero. And we actually think that a risk factor is what's called an exposure that happens to the fetus in utero, and that exposure is the mother's mental health problems. And so really and crucially, what this suggests is that there are three possible pathways by which mental illness may travel in families. So we all think about genes of risk that likely happen in families. And we are pretty used to thinking about a child that grows up in a very, very dysfunctional home, say with an alcoholic parent, an abusive parent, a very, very depressed parent, has a risk for mental health problems. It's a hard way to grow up. Mm-hmm. And we're pushing back the time frame to say there's a third pathway. So the mother's mental health problems while she's pregnant can get transmitted to the fetus and put that child at risk for future mental health problems.
So you're doing research on pregnant women and the fetus,
yes,
in utero. So how do you do that kind of research?
Right. I always like to say, how do you ask the fetus questions? And we are limited. Uh-huh. It's not as easy as you and I having a conversation, obviously. Mm-hmm. But again, there is this developing brain, and there is some fetal behavior, and we can probe that fetal behavior. So some of the ways that the fetus gives us an answer in his or her behavior is heart rate reactivity, so to stimuli, mm-hmm. And also movement reactivity to stimuli, so we mm-hmm. can see individual differences in how fetuses respond to stimuli, mm-hmm. just the way we can see in, say, child temperament at 3 or 4 years old. Some mm-hmm. kids are less or more reactive, even 4 months old, mm-hmm. and now we're pushing the time back. So in mm-hmm. heart rate reactivity to stimuli or movement reactivity, we can see differences in how fetuses are developing.
So what are some of the factors that you're seeing mm-hmm. impacting the reactivity, the behavior, really, of the fetus?
Right. So we've been focused on actually, this maternal experience of distress, mm-hmm. specifically having significant depression or stress or anxiety during your pregnancy, and that actually seems to be associated with differences in how the fetus is developing. Mm-hmm. So let me take a few steps back mm-hmm. and walk you through this. So some researchers going way back to 1967 did a very interesting study, again, asking the fetus questions mm-hmm. and getting the answer in fetal heart rate. Mm-hmm. And what they did, believe it or not, was tell a pregnant woman mm-hmm. towards the end of her pregnancy that she was in a room. Mm-hmm. It had just about half the amount of oxygen needed for life, but that her baby would probably live. And you can imagine, this is a right. life-threatening shock. Uh-huh. Well, her heart rate went right up because uh-huh. they were monitoring her. Uh-huh. And at the same time, the fetus's heart rate went way up. So that tells us that the woman is having an emotional experience. There was uh-huh. no change in the air in the room. Just uh-huh. the thought that this may hurt my baby. Uh-huh. She had a reaction, and so did her fetus. Uh-huh. So we've learned from that paradigm, and we don't give the women a stress that's life-threatening. Thankfully, mm-hmm. we're not allowed to do things like that anymore. Mm-hmm. But we do give women, pregnant women, a stressor in our lab. It's a cognitive challenge. Mm-hmm. And what we've seen is that fetuses whose mothers have significant anxiety and stress in their lives, when their mothers are doing this task and feeling nervous themselves, their heart rate goes up.
So what is the task?
Well, it's called a Stroup color word matching task.
Okay.
And it's been around for almost 50 years in psychology. It's mm-hmm. really a task where you read words, color words, mm-hmm. but in a different color than the word itself.
Okay.
But because we all read so automatically as adults, if you see the word blue mm-hmm. in red ink, you punch down blue, but the right answer is the color of the letters. And when we do the task, we have someone in a white coat letting them know they're not working fast enough. The computer tells them when they get it wrong. So it's a performance anxiety.
Uh-huh.
And interestingly, the women on average do show physiologic and psychological stress reactivity.
Mm-hmm.
But what's really amazing is that fetuses differentiate themselves. So it's only the fetuses of highly anxious and stressed or depressed women that show this heart rate increase during that stressor in the lab.
Mm-hmm.
And then their heart rate goes down when the women are in recovery. So what we think is happening is, again, like a temperament in a baby, these fetuses are more reactive to stimuli. It's a little complicated here, but what the stimuli is, mm-hmm. is that, again, the mother's life is the fetus's life. It's the fetus's experiences. When she has a reaction, she's getting stressed, her heart rate's beating faster, that's sound and vestibular stimuli for the fetus. So some of these fetuses are reacting to their world changing. And some of the other fetuses of the women who don't have distress in their lives, their fetuses, their heart rates don't change.
So you're seeing a really strong correlation then mm-hmm. between the kind of calmness of the fetus and the emotional condition that the mother is in. So when you say stress, anxiety, is it like they have to commute a long way to work? What are the factors that you've identified that are really having this kind of an impact?
Right. That's such an important question because we all have stress in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And, I'm not the only one doing research in this area. There are many different labs across the world, and none of us want to be giving pregnant women something else to worry about. And frankly, we all have a bit of stress in our lives, and many people think fetuses need to feel a little stress because they need to get inoculated. The world out there has ups and downs.
Mm-hmm.
So we're really talking about a serious depression. We're really talking about feeling overwhelmed by life, that you can't handle things. Or, there are many people, anxiety disorders are one of the most common mental health problems. And so just anticipatory, something's going to go wrong, rethinking over and over past things that didn't go well. So mm-hmm. it's really people who are quite, women, I should say, who are quite troubled in their emotional well-being.
Mm-hmm.
But it is on a continuum, mm-hmm. and there's not, a certain cut point where we can say, yes, this woman is affecting the fetus and this woman isn't. Mm-hmm. Fetuses differ in their sensitivity. We're still learning a lot about this.
Mm-hmm.
I think the bottom line is that we need to be paying attention to women's emotional well-being during pregnancy as much as we do to their physical well-being. And by doing so, we can help not only women, but potentially their future children.
So that's what I wanted to ask you. Mm-hmm. So there's a fetus. Some are more reactive in the womb. Some are less reactive. So what? What are the, are you seeing differences in babies and young children after they've been born,
right,
based on what you'd observed, right, in their physical state in the womb?
Yeah, another key question. So first I'll cite research from other labs, or they've followed children mm-hmm. out. Vivek Glover is one of the primary people. And one of the major findings is that, actually I'll tell you two, is that children exposed in utero to either significant maternal anxiety or depression. Now, anxiety is really associated with risk in 6 and 7 year old children showing emotional problems themselves, particularly ADHD. Mm-hmm. And then when girls have been followed, anxiety and depression in their mothers in pregnancy, when these girls go into the puberty period, they're much more at risk for depression. So there are these long-term outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of what we've seen in my lab, because I stop around age two with the kids, mm-hmm. and we don't quite have our data yet for age two, but mm-hmm. we have done follow-up studies. Mm-hmm. The first is that we see these babies who are, as fetuses, are more reactive. They actually do go on at 4 months old to have a more reactive temperament. And that is to a novel mobile being put in front of them. They cry and move more and fuss more. And then going back in time, but looking at the brain directly instead of behavior, we've seen that having greater fetal heart rate reactivity, as I described, mm-hmm. is associated with differences in what's called functional brain connectivity. And we get that by having a newborn resting, being asleep, and going into our MRI scanner. And so we can look at different areas of the brain and how much they are communicating. Mm-hmm. And what we've seen in these newborns is that a part of the brain that's very associated with fear reactions and detecting stimuli and trying to tell if it's a, or at least having a reaction if it's going to be a bad or good experience, mm-hmm. called the amygdala, is more strongly connected to a part of the brain called the prefrontal cortex. And that actually is more the part of the brain that helps us decide if it's something to be worried about or not. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, as a newborn, there's certainly not verbal thinking going on, but the brain is getting connected. And we see that fetuses who have more reactive heart rate, as newborns just resting in the scanner, they have this part of the brain, that the amygdala of the prefrontal cortex, that is more intensely connected, as if they are already ready to be aware of stimuli out in the world.
So the amygdala is the part of the brain deep inside that is thought to be associated with kind of emotional reactions, fight or flight
yes.
instincts. Is that correct?
Absolutely. That's right. Part of the limbic system and key to our having emotional experiences.
So when you are explaining that in these infants who had higher reactivity in the womb, mm-hmm. that their amygdala is somehow more active.
It's actually, that was the second part of our finding, which we didn't go into, is through some complex statistical analyses, and I should really cite my colleague on this, Jonathan Posner, mm-hmm. And Jai Cook Shaw and his lab, they were actually able to see that it was the amygdala, the activity of the amygdala, just as you've anticipated, that was driving this greater connectivity. Mm-hmm. So that's exactly right.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching part one of our discussion with Dr. Katharine Monk. If you enjoyed what you saw, remember to like the video or leave us a comment. And if you want to see more, please check out part two.